All right. Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church of Norristown, both to you in the room and everyone online. It's good to be here this morning. I'm your guest worship leader, Dr. Chris Wells, filling in for CG while he's away. And I'll give you a little inside scoop. If you don't like the way it goes this morning, you plan to be somewhere else on the 30th because I'm back then as well. But hopefully everyone gets filled up with the Spirit this morning. We have a good time of worship. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time where we can gather in your house. Lord, I thank you for these people, both here in the room and online. I ask that you would just honor the promise of Scripture that wherever two or three gathered, you will be there with us, Lord. We ask for more of your Spirit. We ask for a blessing in the Word this morning. I ask that you would anoint Natalie, help her speak your truths, and help us to worship you well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Light in my darkness, peace for my soul. You are my rescue, you never let go. Light in my darkness, for my soul, you are my rescue, you never let go.
All my hope,
all my hope is in you, and all my strength is in my soul will rest in you. Here in my weakness, always the same, your love is my shelter, your life is my way. Come now, fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. For I spoke a word, you are singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. For I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When I was your foe, steal your love far from me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me.
Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
You believe that?
No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Let's make that declaration.
No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
One more.
No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. So wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Holy, overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the night.
Be seated. So something I wanted to talk about today is fear, right? And so fear, especially when we have so much going on in our lives, so many different situations piling up on us, fear will have us believe some of the craziest things, right? It'll tell us that we can't do it. It'll tell us that we're not smart enough, that we're weak, that we'll never get out of the situation that we're in, that we will always be alone, and that this is the biggest one, that nothing will ever change. And I want you to remember that through these words in Isaiah 41:10. In Isaiah 41:10 says, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand." So, a few ways that you're able to give, right? You have the QR code on the back of your chairs. You can give by mail or in person. You can also give at fbcnorristown.org. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time that you've given us to worship you, to speak on how amazing and how faithful and how strong and wonderful that you are, Lord. And I thank you for the love that you give us that is so unexplainable that cannot be put into a single word, Lord. And I thank you for the youth group. I thank you for the community of believers we have here today that go and serve the community in so many different ways, Lord, and they give in so many different ways. And I pray that you continue to push our hearts into giving in all the different ways that you call us to give, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church family. My name is Jocelyn De Jesus Fisher, and I'm just going to announce some ways that we can connect with each other and connect with God and connect with our community. So if you're a visitor today, welcome to First Baptist Church of Norristown. We have green cards in front of you that if you can please fill out the card so that we can get to know you better, that'd be great. And we also have yellow cards in front of you in the back of the pews. If you have a prayer request that you would like for the church to pray over, please fill out that card, and I will take that for you when you're done. So FBCN Women's Retreat is going to be in Ocean City, New Jersey, and it's going to be the weekend of September 27th through the 29th. I did join that a couple years ago, and it was very beautiful. It was enlightening and a lot of fun to hang out with the ladies. So maybe I'll be doing that again this year. And please contact Leslie. No? Okay. So correction, it's September 27th to the 28th. So one overnight. Thank you. Thank you, Leslie. Watch care update. Please see the bulletin for ways our church family can help Doug and Laura Schrack and Gail and Paul Mendacria. We've done meal trains before for people in need, and if you would like to volunteer and help out with that, please contact myself if you would like to take part in that. And Hope on the Hill. We're looking for suggestions for the property behind the church. Drop your suggestions in the box in the Welcome Center. And next outdoor service is going to be Sunday, June 23rd at 10:30 a.m. And if you have trouble going uphill, we do valet up on the hill.
Let's go to God in prayer. Loving and merciful God, whose power is beyond our scope and whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, we turn to you in faith, assured that you know our every emotion and are aware of our every need. Our thoughts and prayers today are turned towards our fathers. For those fathers who increase the joy in our lives, we give you thanks. For those fathers whose presence is greatly missed, may we take time to gratefully recall all that they have given us, providing for us in our growing. For those who have recently lost or who are facing the imminent loss of their own fathers, may they find comfort in their grief, hope in their despair, courage in the love that their fathers have given them. We give thanks, God, for those good men who sustain and support us in our living, who love us no matter what a blessing they are to all who know them. We give thanks to you, O God, for all those whose gift of fatherhood is so strong, they have allowed their caring to spill over into the lives of others, providing the guidance and stability, the nurture and the love needed. We pray for fathers whose relationships with their children have been difficult or disappointing. We pray, too, for those who have been denied a chance to be fathers, and for those whose years of parenting have been cut short by the loss of a child. We turn to you, most holy God, knowing, trusting that you can console where consolation seems impossible. May they receive comfort for their soul and peace and hope for living, that their gifts may not be denied to others. And now we turn to you, God, once more by reciting the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'm always grateful when CG gives me an opportunity to use my theology skills. But when I saw that it was an option to pick Father's Day to preach, I had to grab it. That'll be easy, I thought. My dad was a great pastor. I'll just talk about him. Turned out to be not so easy. God seems to use each preaching opportunity I have to get me to dig deep and do some soul cleansing on whatever topic it is. So I'm not sure why it came as any surprise that I went through the ringer about my dad when trying to figure out how to verbalize just what it was that made him so special. And to do this, I'll start with some pictures. In the honor of Father's Day, I have this photo that was off Facebook a couple years ago. That's our wedding. And then up at the top, that's my dad with our two boys. Then my dad and the three siblings, our wedding. And then the bottom picture is him and us at a church in Cleveland, Ohio. That's me and my dad when I was about 4 years old. This was him on a Father's Day. I don't remember what it was, but the three of us made a very awesome t-shirt for him on Father's Day with all of our little handprints on the back there. Grandfather. That was one of the last pictures that we actually got with him and my boys, our boys. He was a twin. He was an identical twin. And I'll tell you, when I was younger, there were times that I mistook one for the other. It was kind of terrifying to hug someone and look up and be like, oh, that's not my dad. That's not him. He was a pastor for 31 years, American Baptist pastor. He was a husband. My mother and he were married for, 40 years? My brother's back there, I'm looking at him. a long time. They married when they were young, about 20 years old. And then this is also one of the last pictures I got to take with my dad, and it's kind of been ingrained in my mind, him walking into the light of God. I want to take a second to pause and read our scripture for today, which is Romans 15, 7 to 13. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you, for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore, I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. And again, he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the people praise him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse shall come, the one who rises to the rule of the Gentiles. In him the Gentiles shall hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I want to start back at the beginning, though. Martin Lewis Rolfs Massaglia was born on June 3, 1952, in Independence, Kansas. As I said, he came as a twin, an identical twin. His twin brother Mark would never let him live down that he was older. His family was very involved in church, which is where he and my mother met. It was a youth group romance. The twins had a reputation of being a little loud and out of control. They were the middle of four boys. Nonetheless, the family always entertained and participated in church and community events. My dad was a drummer in the high school band and later the drum major, of course. Massaglia's often ended up as the leader of whatever group they decided to be in. However, theater was his real passion. Dad went to college at Fort Hays State University and majored in theater. Not your typical precursor to seminary. He was there with his twin Mark and my mother, who he married at the young age of 20. After college, they did a stint in the army stationed in Germany. But 4 years was enough for my dad, and somewhere in the midst of that, he decided to go to seminary. Everyone seemed to be surprised that my dad chose to go to seminary. He was not very biblically savvy, but he threw himself into theology like he did anything else. Somewhere in his life, my dad figured out that the real living was in the experiences, the people, the connections. It seemed like he knew everyone. I always thought, how could one person know so many people? There isn't enough time in the day. This same question entered my mind at his funeral service. He died about 10 years ago. It was a Tuesday afternoon during a snowstorm in Cleveland, Ohio, and there were over 300 people there for the service. How could one man touch all those lives? What does he do that inspired hundreds to come from all over the country in a snowstorm? Just think if it was on the weekend in the middle of the summer. My dad was a lot of things. He was an actor, director, writer, drummer, a bocce referee, a cook, a journalist, an army veteran, coffee lover, father, grandfather, husband, brother. But these were not what brought all those people there. For me, after he died, it was really challenging. I felt depleted. I felt like that I went backwards. I sunk into a little bit of a depression. I feel like we all did, all of us in the family, all of the lives he touched. I felt like it kind of fell apart. I mean, we were keeping it together. We found joy in being together and celebrating the memories we had, honoring his life. We got tattoos in his honor. We dedicated a bench to the church in his name. We spread his ashes at all the three places he said he wanted. On hard days, we asked ourselves, what would Martin do? He always had a solution. And these things helped to keep a bit of his spirit alive. But still, it was hard. For at least the first 5 years, I would have just called it grief. But once I was able to get my head above the horizon and take a deep breath, I began to understand for myself what it felt like to experience living a life powered not by sheer force, not by human strength and willpower, but by a relationship with God. I knew exactly what it was that brought hundreds of people to his funeral that day. He loved us with the unconditional love of God. Every person he crossed paths with, every person he met in every theater, every committee, every school, every facet of life, he loved them with the unconditional love of God. There was no judgment, no hierarchy, there was no fear. He brought us all together. He strung us together, empowered us, held us up, connected us with this thread that none of us could even see because he did it in a way that was so humble, it was almost undetectable. And when he left the earth as a physical being, I believe we all felt the absence of this huge, loving presence and have been trying to stabilize ever since. At least I have. Until one day I realized, with the help of seminary, with the help of recovery, I realized what it was. And now I can start sowing it myself. I picked this passage today because, again, I thought it would be easy. It was one of my dad's favorites. He used verse 13 as his benediction for every single sermon he ever gave. As a kid, I could recite it up and down, blind, but I never really took time to think about why he said it at the end of every service. Why this passage? What was he trying to convey? Well, the more I've learned about it, it really is perfectly aligned with who he was and what I would say defines the way he tried to live. He thought community and a unity were essential. He had faith in the Bible and the teachings of Christ, and the only way to live a life truly of joy and peace was to do so powered by the Holy Spirit. In today's verse, I think Paul was trying to convey that same message to the libertines in the Roman church. They were enjoying the freedoms of what it feels like to live a life not burdened by law, but they were taking it for granted. Jesus wanted this way of living to not only free the Jews, but the Gentiles as well. He's encouraging them to live out life in the same way I described my dad. He wanted them to embrace unity, to have faith in Scripture and teachings of Christ, and bring hope to everyone they met by living empowered by nothing but the Holy Spirit. He wanted them to create that same thread of unconditional love that my dad did in all of us. Growing up, I always knew I was lucky when it came to pastors and churches, not just because it was my dad, but because of the way my friends talked about their pastors and churches. What they said sounded awful. It was boring. They made them feel guilty. They were mean. They weren't allowed to do this. They didn't accept that. They couldn't wear this. You couldn't do that in church because you weren't a member. I always used to say, well, my church isn't like that. You should come and hear my dad speak. In his sermons, he laid out his humanity right for everyone to see. I didn't know what it was back then, but as I got older, I quickly understood that in our church, my dad nurtured an environment that was real life, it was inclusive, and accepted everybody. Unity and acceptance were so ingrained in me that I just thought it was the norm. I remember thinking, if God is love, then why does any church ever not accept someone? My dad encouraged unity and community in any way he could. We accepted people from any denomination. I remember when I went to the Catholic Church with my best friend, I felt like I was such an outsider that I was judged. They never did that at our church. We could wear casual clothes. My dad encouraged people to call him Martin. He started a theater company in our church, which put on a play every single summer, and we invited the community to come in and join us, which he actually had to get approval for because some people were against it. He was always cutting edge and pushed the congregation to go a little outside their comfort zone when it came to inclusivity. Many of the things we do in this church today, but were controversial back then. Our church facilitated MLK Day and Martin Luther King Jr. Day events with inner city churches. Juneteenth is coming up on the 19th. This is also called Freedom Day or Emancipation Day, which celebrates the day the Union troops informed the remaining enslaved people that they were free. And my dad would have been the first to incorporate that into his ministry. He supported LGBTQ even before the woke culture was a thing. My dad preached with inclusive language. For those of you that don't know, that means he did not use father or any gender to identify God. He did so because of things like Father's Day. And while Father's Day can be a positive for a lot, it is also difficult for many who did not have a good relationship with their father. He also did it because he believed God was above race, position, or gender. Galatians 3:28. There is neither Greek nor Jew, slave nor free, male or female, for you are all one in Jesus Christ. In the first two verses of today's passage, Paul spells out that it's not just the Jews that deserve to live in this new free way, but the Gentiles too. Christ teaches us everybody gets a seat at the table. In the Message version of the scripture, it reads, Jesus, staying true to God's purpose, reached out in a special way to the Jewish insiders so that old ancestral promises would come true for them. As a result, the non-Jewish outsiders have been able to experience mercy and to show appreciation to God. There are no limitations to who God loves. He He has that same thread of unconditional love. Community and unity through Christ has always been the goal, and Paul shows us in the four scriptures he quotes. He quotes them to say, look at these scriptures. Look at all that will come true if we love like this. Let's take a quick look at the four scriptures he picked. 2 Samuel 22:50. So I will give you thanks, O Lord, before the nations. I will sing praises to you. This is the combined and harmonious praise of Jews and Gentiles, and it's God's will and what God always intended. The second scripture is Deuteronomy 32:43. Cry out, O nations, with his people, for he will avenge his servants' blood. He will take vengeance against his enemies and take atonement for his land and people. It's saying outsiders and insiders rejoice together. No boundaries. The third scripture that Paul quotes is from Psalms 117:1. Praise the Lord, all you nations. Applaud him and all you foreigners. And here's the ideal for the church. Unity and harmony. They should be the evidence of the grace of God in our lives. And the final scripture he quotes is from Isaiah 11:10. At that time, a root from Jesse will stand like a signal flag for all nations. Nations will look to him for guidance, and his residence will be majestic. If unity and harmony between Jews and Gentiles is God's purpose, if it's God's will, a certainty in and for eternity, the standard and ideal for the church today, then walking in love is a necessity. Specifically, we dare not accept others in order to judge them or in order to cause them to stumble. We must accept others in order to build them up so that we may all, in unity and harmony, praise God. One theologian writes, Christ remains the decisive factor for the community. Then the community can reach unity through its diversity and thus glorify God. Sounds pretty clear to me. Faith in what all these scriptures were telling us, faith in Christ's example as fully divine and fully human, faith in his example of unity, community, and non-judgment, no exclusions, no exceptions, just unconditional love. Faith in all those things that will lessen pain, will lessen struggle, will lessen fear, will lessen the separation that human beings are born to. They're born in the of a sinful nature and puts us between us and God. This brings me to verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The version that I just said is from the NRSV. It took me a while to find, but the version my dad used for the entire 30 years of his ministry was from the English Standard Version, and it reads, May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace and believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound. It's a small difference, but I can't say it any other way. But what is hope? What was he leaving us with at the end of every sermon? Why is it good to have hope? The subject of hopes comes up a lot in my line of work. I'm a counselor in a recovery center where individuals are trying to learn how to overcome addiction. Addiction can feel like a pretty hopeless state. You feel like you're trying with all your might to fight something, but you can't stop it from ruining your life. The big book of Alcoholics Anonymous says that no human power could relieve us from our alcoholism. Hope is essential. Yet all the people I work with don't have a relationship with Christ or any sort of God or higher power. So how do you teach hope? What can they find hope in before they find that higher power and connection? Well, often they find hope in the fact that other people have had similar struggles, yet have gone on to live a life free from addiction. They trust what they see. They have faith in what other people have done and that has worked. And they trust the text. The sentence after the one I read in the big book says, God can relieve us of our alcoholism and will if he is sought. They trust in a power greater than themselves. These are the two parts of hope that Paul shows us in verse 13. The God of hope will fill you with joy and peace if you believe, if you have faith. If you have faith that the scriptures, as he showed us earlier, and faith that the stories told of God are true, and faith that if you follow a life like Jesus and you mimic what Jesus did, live the way Jesus lived, then you will live a life that's full of joy and peace in a world where we see so much pain and struggle. The second kind of hope Paul is talking about is hope that we are being empowered and powered by the Holy Spirit. Jesus was both human and divine, and my belief is that he came to show us what is possible. All of us are capable of the things that Jesus did, to live and love the way he spoke. If we try to follow the guidance of the Ten Commandments, if we listen to the stories of what worked to bring people closer to God, like praise, gratitude, repentance, community, unity, and acceptance, if we pray, if we rest on the Sabbath, then we will be casting aside our human nature of sin and getting closer and closer to the divine nature that is in all of us, the power of the Holy Spirit. Paul was telling us that this way, and only this way, will it be possible to live in unity and harmony and get a glimpse of heaven here on earth. I don't know about you, but I can tell when I'm living a life that brings me closer to the divine creation of God that I am, and I can tell when I am living in what the way I'm living is separating me from God. We are not designed to be separate. We are designed to be one. I love the way Michael Singer talks about this in his book, The Untethered Soul. Chapter 19 is entitled The Loving Eyes of God, and the whole chapter is powerful. But I love this part when he says, when the hand of God reaches out to give through you, there's nothing that you wouldn't give. You would give your last breath and never even think about it. It wouldn't even cross your mind to hold back. You would give anything and everything for your beloved. When you feel love this deeply, you feel that it is coming from something greater than you. It is transcendental love. The ones that went beyond said it's the state that you attain when you drift into the Spirit. And that is how Spirit looks upon its creation. That is what you should be taught. No matter what you do and no matter what you've done, you will always be loved by him. This is how I feel like I'm loving when I'm empowered by the Holy Spirit. I often pray to see everyone around me through God's eyes because it feels so much better to live and love unconditionally than to be hurt, angry, resentful, or hopeless. And this is how I feel like my dad lived, the only way he could have done all that, powered by the Holy Spirit. When I was about 3 or 4, my dad was rushed to the hospital and he almost died. They found a tumor on his lungs. That day, he had a spiritual experience and later wrote about it. He said that an angel told him that they weren't ready for him yet. He had a lot more work to do. And I never really got a chance to talk to him about it, but I believe something shifted in him that day. They found out he had a thymoma tumor, a very rare type of cancerous tumor. And they gave him 5 years to live, but God had other plans. He lived with that cancer for 26 years. It didn't stay away. It came back again and again, first when I was in my teens. He went through chemotherapy, and back then it was a pretty awful experience. He would get a treatment and then be sick in bed for almost a week. And he kept it very quiet how much pain he was in and how hard it was. But powered by the Holy Spirit, he never stopped. He was here to do as much of God's work as possible, and he did not know how much time he had left. He lived every single day like it was his last. The cancer came back numerous times. He would just inform us that it was back and what was going on, and then take care of business. He had no fear because he knew what he was fueled by. You could see it in the way he welcomed change. You could see it in the way he pushed his coworkers and congregations to be more, to do more, to connect more. You could see it in the way he embraced confrontation. You could see it in the way he stood up for the less fortunate. You could see it in the way he was not afraid to challenge the norm and live each and every day, weaving this thread of unconditional love, which ended up joining everyone he met in this massive unity community. He used Jesus' life and ministry as a guide and gave everyone he met hope. And that's why we asked ourselves, what would Martin do? My dad spent the first 22 years in his ministry at Royersford Baptist Church, just up the road. That's where I grew up. At some point, he felt called to reach more people in a more diverse community. So the last 10 years of his ministry and life, he was at the First Baptist Church of Greater Cleveland in Ohio. I was in my mid-20s and my rebellious stage. But by what I'm sure is the power of God, I made the six-hour trek and got there to hear his first sermon. And I'll never forget it. With his background in theater, he had a very dramatic and impactful way of preaching. At the end of this sermon, he actually had a background soundtrack of people cheering and encouraging to finish the race. He was encouraging a congregation who had been drugged through some difficult times to not give up of living in a Christian way, and he encouraged them to do this by working as a community, having faith, keeping their eyes on Jesus, and I think it depicts exactly what Paul is trying to tell these early believers. The verse is Hebrews 12:1-3. The verses are, Do you see what this means? All these pioneers who blazed the way, all these veterans cheering us on, it means we better get on with it. Strip down, start running and never quit. No extra spiritual fat, no parasitic sins. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who both began and finished this race we're in. Study how he did it, because he never lost sight of where he was headed. That exhilarating finish in and with God, he could put up with anything along the way, cross, shame, whatever, and now he's there in the place of honor, right alongside God. When you find yourselves flagging in your faith, go over that story again, item by item, that long litany of hostility he plowed through. That will shoot adrenaline into your souls. I happened to find the recording of this sermon, so I wanted to leave you today with the way he ended it and give you a little taste of the power of the Holy Spirit and a little bit of that hope.
I do not know if there is any other way to get around that track and persevere together, to endure the stuff that every one of us has to endure in our lives and in our church, the hardships, the disappointments, the sin that clings to us, the obstacles in our way, the misunderstandings and the disagreements and the imperfections. I do not know how First Baptist will rid itself of the things that weighed it down, recover from past mistakes, come together in its diversity, fulfill God's dream for it. I do not know how to persevere in the face of all these things and those things which are before us without, as the author of Hebrews says, keeping our eyes on Jesus, who began and finished the race we're in. And what does it mean to keep our eyes on Jesus? It means following the leader, the one who has already blazed the trail for us. It means doing what he did, the one who never stepped out of the race, the one who stayed in the game. Just watch him, just study him, just follow him, and you will move closer and closer to that finish line. And pay careful attention to the fact that the author of Hebrews doesn't say, look to Moses or Abraham or Sarah or Rahab or Paul or Martin Luther King or Mother Teresa or even Oprah. He says, keep your eyes on Jesus. Do what he did, and you will be able to stay in the race. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who declared that he had come to save and not condemn the world. Jesus, who repeatedly warned us of the danger of wealth. Jesus, who told us that if we sought right living over riches, we'd find contentment and also have all we needed. Jesus, who was stern with self-righteous religious leaders and compassionate toward the marginalized, the poor, and the deeply troubled in the world. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who told us not to judge, not to hate, not to live by the sword, but to love and to speak peace and reconciliation. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who saw the potential for sainthood in common laborers and tax collectors and revolutionaries and doubters and a Christian killer. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who never stopped loving or forgiving, even in the face of hardship and persecution and death. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who died for the salvation of not only those who agreed with him, but those who steadfastly opposed him. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who never stepped out of the race, who never quit, who persevered for our sake and for the sake of the kingdom of God. And as you run that long and difficult race with your eyes on Jesus, remember that those superheroes of the faith who persevered in their lives have filled the seats of the stadium right now and surround us with their hope and their faith and their witness so that we will persevere in our own lives and together as a body.
Thank you, Natalie, for that message, touching tribute to your father. I hope one day that my kids say things half that nice about me. In response to that message, would you stand and we'll sing a song of hope, Oceans.
You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Sovereign hands will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail and you won't start now. And I will call upon your keep my eyes above the waves.
rest. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my I will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves. My soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours, and you.
With all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. Amen. Amen.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without